Good morning. Good to be back with you this morning after a little travel to Tennessee. I didn't realize how beautiful Tennessee was and saw probably one of the most amazing sunsets I've ever seen. Unfortunately, it was over the city of Nashville, but it was like the sun was on fire. God's great in his creation, and I know you all experienced a mild climate here as well with above average temperatures. As we worship our Lord today, we're grateful for all who are here. Tonight there are small groups at various times and locations, and be sure to, if you are not part of a small group and want to, be sure to hit one of the deacons or the ushers up to get plugged in there. Tuesday morning there is prayer time here at 8 a.m. There's also a youth group tonight. Sorry, I overlooked that one. But there is no Kids for Truth on Wednesday night due to the Thanksgiving holiday on Thursday. No Kids for Truth this week. And then Saturday, 4 p.m. is Young Adults. And then coming up on December 9 is the Adult Christmas Banquet. This week, or next week, Sunday, will be the last Sunday to sign up for attendance because we have to turn in the number for the caterer. And we're also asking members to bring a salad or a dessert. So there's two sign-up sheets back there, one for your attendance and one for what you are, put your name down, but also what you are bringing, whether it's a salad or a dessert. So please see that on the kitchen counter here after our service. And that is all my announcements.
I should also mention one other announcement that I failed to tell Corey, and that is that at the beginning of the Sunday school hour, we will all start together. We're going to have a presentation by Klee of a pastor in Pakistan who is looking for assistance in purchasing Bibles. And so it's just going to be a brief presentation, maybe 5-10 minutes, to give you some insight into what's going on there and an opportunity to give if you wish over the next couple of weeks. All right, please stand with me as we sing, "O Worship the King."
Lord, as we reflect on our lives this week or this month or just even today, Lord, We ask that we can be sorrowful for our sin and come to you asking for forgiveness, and you promise to forgive us. Lord, your mercies are new every morning, and you are faithful in all things. And Lord, we are just so grateful for your faithfulness. Lord, maybe some are here today carrying burdens. Some are here being joyful because they have been healed from the sickness, or that today is just one of those days that they feel great. Lord, we pray for those who are not able to be with us because of sickness, because of Raleigh in particular, and that he can feel better soon. Thankful for the progress that the doctors have made in diagnosing what his ailments are. Lord, we know there are others suffering from ailments as well, and they're kept confidential. Or maybe it's something within them, a mental challenge that's going on. We just pray that today you will help them conquer their fears, that the devil will be turned aside, Lord, and that victory can happen in their mind and their heart. Lord, we're grateful for the weather that you provided for us. Lord, the mild temperatures here in late November. And Lord, as we celebrate the season of Thanksgiving this week, Lord, we know we have much to be thankful for. We could spend our time complaining about the things that we don't have, or the ailments that we have, Lord. But we have so much to be grateful for, and most of all, that you've sent your Son to die on the cross for our sins. Lord, as we worship you today, let him give passionate words to say. Let him be efficient and effective in his words. Or whatever bothering us, let us block that out and focus on the message and focus on what you have for us to receive in today's message. Lord, as we go through this week, let today be a stepping stone for victory this week, for thankfulness. Not only just this week or on Thursday, Lord, for thankfulness, Lord, but each day that we can be thankful for the provisions that you provided for us. And that is your service, and we'll go out and be effective in sharing the good news to those around us and sharing why we have hope for the future. We pray all this in your name. Amen. Psalm 86, 11 through 13. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever.
For great is your steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol.
And can it be that I should take it?
Oh, 2 Corinthians 3:15 through 18. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of God, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit.
Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what thou art.
Thank you. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Please stand for me as we sing, "It is well with my soul."
Thank you.
Please turn in your Bibles to Numbers chapter 16. Numbers chapter 16, please. I feel a little hot. There's a number of different ways you can understand that. Numbers chapter 16. Our plan this morning is actually going to be to review the history of the nation of Israel from about the time that the book of Exodus starts until this event, with a particular facet of their national identity in mind. That's going to prepare us for the sorts of things that happen in Numbers chapter 16. And then we will go through what happens here in this, which is often called Korah's Rebellion. We'll go through what is happening here in this particular passage. And with a view of the past 2.5 years, I hope we'll be able to understand some of the dynamics of what's happening among the people of Israel, and through a particular series of events, be able to draw application to the way that we operate in our world, in our homes, in our church, in our workplace. Now, the facet of Israel's function as a nation is actually that we're going to be focusing on this morning is their government. During slavery, they didn't really have much in the way of government. Whatever they had, it was pretty limited. And I think we can arrive at this conclusion pretty securely, because when they actually were delivered from slavery, it becomes evident in both Exodus and Numbers that they needed organization. We looked at a passage earlier in the book of Numbers, and there's another one in Exodus where God and Moses and the people work together to provide 72 elders, and those 72 elders end up having other representatives underneath them that represent thousands of families, and those elders have people underneath them that represents hundreds of families, and those have elders under them who represent groups of 10 families. And so an architecture, a bureaucracy, it's the right word, a bureaucracy is developed, which didn't exist while they were in slavery. I would guess that this is happening here in the people of Israel, because while they did understand which tribe they were from, the tribes were sub-nations, and they were able to organize themselves by tribe pretty securely, when they had disputes and when they had problems, just like the rest of us in these days, when we have a problem with a coworker or with a neighbor, sometimes we can work it out. And between the people involved in that problem, we manage to work it out and it doesn't escalate. I think that they lived like we do in that sense. When they had issues with their neighbors, they worked it out or they didn't. They just tolerated it. But when things did escalate, they didn't have a government while they were in slavery. They didn't have a government that they escalated those things through, which is evident because when they no longer were in slavery in Egypt, they escalated everything directly to Moses. And Moses' father-in-law looks at Moses' day, where he sits in judgment on case after case after case, and says, Moses, this isn't working out. You need a bureaucracy. You need to split the labor up. So I think we can say from that statement that they didn't have an organized government while they were in slavery, but when things escalated to the Egyptians. And absent the Egyptians, their masters, they did not have much in the way of government. Now, as they traveled after being delivered from slavery, we do see a government and a bureaucracy developing. And this is a government that is growing toward theocracy. That is, the ultimate head of that government isn't a president, it isn't a council, it isn't even Moses. The ultimate head of that government is God himself. They travel to Mount Sinai, and they get better organized, even just by necessity, because they have to get up and go every morning. And at night, they have to set up their tents, and they have to unpack some stuff so they can eat and sleep. And then the next morning, they have to pack it all up again and get up and go. And so as they practice this over and over again, over many trips, they undoubtedly got more skilled and more organized at doing it. But added to this skill of organization through experience were a number of mandates from God on how he wanted their government to exist. And the government ultimately led up to him. By the time we get into the book of Numbers, we see that this system of government, that God has decreed, is very thoroughly developed. And portions of that government remain within the tribes. The tribes have their own system of reporting and of handling issues among one another. And that system works very well. So well, in fact, that we have these extended lists in the book of Numbers that we've already looked at in previous months. And those lists are actually representative or summaries of other lists that each tribe held. Lists that were an exhaustive accounting of everyone that was there in among the people of Israel. And these lists were kept and they were updated. The status of people was changed. When a person passed away, it was notated on the list. When a person was born, they were added to the list.